possibly the biggest supply chain malware attack just happened, with the malware potentially being downloaded around up to 50 million times before it was detected. But surprisingly, it seems like it may have been the biggest, but not the worst. In fact, maybe not a lot happened with it, so how is that even possible? Let's get into it. Though theoretically, we might not actually be at the end of it, but I'll discuss all that. And how was this malware actually distributed? Something called NPM. NPM is a so-called package manager for JavaScript. Basically, it lets developers download pre-made source code tools that they can put into their software that they're working on. For example, if you're working on some app and for part of it you need to convert a file type or data format, instead of manually coding all that yourself, someone probably already made a package for doing that, so you download the package and include that in your code. And anyone can create their own project and put it up on the package manager so it can be downloaded, and obviously you do this with an account. And what happened is the developer of many different very popular packages totaling around 2.5 billion weekly downloads got phished just the other day. This was likely a targeted spear phishing attack, and I'll explain how exactly he got phished in a second, but the hackers wasted no time once they had access to his NPM account in publishing and adding malicious versions of the packages as new versions so that people would start downloading it. And because of how popular these packages were, if you look at just even every second, that is 4,000 downloads every second that these malicious packages were up total. And apparently these packages were up for anywhere from 2 to 3 hours or so. That means that you could say it was about 45 million downloads to be expected. And this is not just gonna affect those who directly downloaded it, by the way. Because this is infected packages that go into software, this is actually targeting the end users that would be using the software this was downloaded into. But not only that though, because it's not just the apps that directly rely on one of these packages. It could be that other packages rely on these packages. So if you install any of those, then you'll also install the malicious one. For example, one of the more popular packages has over 120,000 dependents, meaning other packages that rely on that one. Another package has 55,000 dependents. Now that would all be built into the 2.5 billion per week, but still. Now the malicious versions of each of the packages were nuked and completely removed. So unfortunately I can't see exactly how many times they were downloaded, but apparently NPM might not even update that stat very often, because some people were saying, oh, the website said it, they all had zero downloads, but obviously some people were downloading it even if to just see what it was or analyze it. So that just means the stats were not updated. So what did this malware actually do? Well, the main thing it was designed to do was steal cryptocurrency transactions. And it was designed so that it would detect when it itself was running within a browser window. And then if it did, it had two different modes of attack. But first, it's important to realize that a ton of different apps use embedded browser windows, not just web browsers. This includes everything from Spotify to Microsoft Teams, Slack, Discord, Steam, a bunch of other stuff. It could also include browser extensions or even end up in mobile apps, and not to mention wallet apps themselves. Now, the first mode that this malware would operate in is it would look to see if the current browser it was running in had any web page that was showing a cryptocurrency address. And if it was, it would replace that address with a hard-coded address in the malware. So if anyone went to send money to something, like a website saying, here's the payment address, they would unknowingly send it to the hacker. The second mode of attack was a bit more sophisticated, and it was designed to detect if it was kind of running alongside a crypto wallet. So like if one of the malicious packages was being used in a wallet project or extension or something, or it could have been if it detected that it wasn't maybe part of the wallet app, but the wallet app was running, something like that. Anyway, in that case, if it detected the wallet app, it would actually intercept the transaction request that was going to the wallet, like it, between the website and the wallet extension or something, and would replace the address. So the website, I guess, might have shown an address, and then the wallet request receiving it would be different. So if someone didn't check that they were signing the transaction and that that address was the same as the one on the site, then they would then sign a malicious transaction. But it was a little bit more tricky than that, because it actually had a bunch of different hard-coded addresses, about 40 addresses each for several different cryptocurrencies, and would actually check which of the cryptocurrencies in its list was the closest to the one that it was kind of doing a man-in-the-middle attack of. So it was possibly harder to detect if you were just eyeing it at a quick glance whether or not it was the same. But the big question is, did the attack work? Well, the resulting Ethereum address that all these transactions would have gone to currently has about $1,000 in it, but I'm not sure how much of that would have been actual victims versus people just memeing or sending junk tokens to it. People yesterday were saying that, oh, it only got like about $50. So it seems like it's probably more than that. But in any case, I mean, considering the scope of how much malware they potentially were able to distribute, this doesn't seem like it was a lot. However, I will point out that just because it was detected within a few hours, if in that time frame, a developer of an app either updated the packages for a project that depended on that, or they downloaded one of those packages initially for a project, then theoretically that project is still infected if they'd never updated it after that. So if the developer didn't check the news or something, hypothetically there could still be infected apps out there. That being said, I do expect antivirus makers can probably create a signature for the malicious file that was in those packages so that you could probably detect it, I would imagine, even if it ended up in some app. So I wouldn't worry too much about it. In any case, it could have been a lot worse. I mean, it was initially detected, I think like after just 15 minutes, people were pointing it out. So I'm actually kind of surprised that NPM, the site, actually took that long to take them all down. So how did the developer actually get phished anyway? Well, it really wasn't anything special. He posted a comment on Y Combinator Hacker News, and he basically just kind of admitted, yeah, I just got. It wasn't even a particularly special phishing email. It just looked kind of legit, and he was on mobile. It basically said you have to reset your two-factor authentication or whatever, and instead of going to the website to do it, he just clicked the link in the email and got phished. Of course, not realizing that it wasn't from the actual NPM domain, it was from a .help domain. Now, the hackers only targeted and compromised his NPM account. It's not like they got his GitHub account. So they uploaded the malicious packages directly to the package manager. So it's not like it went through GitHub and was released on there. So you're not going to find the malicious code in any of the commits or releases on the GitHub accounts. Though some people did upload copies of the malware, clearly labeled, obviously, if you want to inspect it or something. I'm not going to link to it directly because YouTube can sometimes be overzealous with links that potentially go to malware, but it should be easy to search for if you want. So do you need to do anything to protect yourself? Probably not. If you are a cryptocurrency user, I mean, using a hardware wallet is always going to be very important. And for this attack, it would depend on the mode that the thing was in. Like, you could obviously detect it if it was in that second mode where you could just inspect the address very, very carefully, which you should be doing anyway. But if it was the one where it was just replacing the address immediately anyway, well, you would never know that that was not the one that you should have been sending it to. So really, there's not anything special you can do. But again, it seems like this was caught really early and probably didn't affect or infect too many people, if at all. So I wouldn't worry about it. And I think supply chain attacks like this are just gonna become more popular. Kind of reminds me of that XZ compression archive malware attack that was extremely sneaky and sophisticated. Like, the hacker literally spent a year carefully contributing to a project just so they could eventually sneak in some malware, but fortunately it was detected. And that didn't target just cryptocurrency wallets, that targeted like literally any kind of software. I mean, crazy stuff. So I'll put a link to that video you can click on. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.